Coming up in today's newscast, red alert sirens sound off across Israel's north. The United States increases tariffs on Israeli metal workers. And finally, Yaacov Agam's famed fountain, Fire and Water, returns. Breaking news from Israel's north, a Patriot missile was just launched from the northern city of Tzfat in response to an unmanned aerial vehicle from Syria. According to witness reports and the IDF, red alert sirens were sounded across the Golan Heights and Jordan Valley in response to the launching of a Patriot missile. More details are still unfolding, but according to some media sources, impact with the drone was reported above Tiberias. While it's not yet known who is behind the drone, this incident comes just days after Israel allegedly struck the T-4 base in Syria and just hours ahead of Prime Minister Netanyahu's meeting with Russian President Vladimir Putin in Moscow. The two leaders are reportedly set to discuss this and similar issues.
אני יוצא עכשיו למוסקווה לפגישה חשובה מאוד עם נשיא רוסיה ולדימיר פוטין. אנחנו נדון על סוריה, נדון על איראן, נדון על צורכי הביטחון של ישראל. אני מאוד מעריך את הקשר הישיר, הבלתי אמצעי, המצוין שיש לי עם נשיא רוסיה. זה מאוד חשוב לביטחון הלאומי של מדינת ישראל.
After heavy debate, opposition, and criticism, the drafters of the nation-state bill may now be rewriting the bill in hopes of passing it into law by the end of next week. The proposed legislation would essentially enshrine much of the country's Jewish identity into the backbone of the country's basic laws. But critics, including President Rivlin, the Attorney General, and even the Knesset's own legal advisor, say parts of the bill may actually harm the Jewish state.
The particular section in question is the 7B clause, which would allow communities to essentially choose who can live within the community based solely on religious grounds or nationalistic grounds. But President Rivlin, in a rare public rebuke, slammed the entire nature of this idea. Rivlin voiced the concern of many who feel that this is nothing short of total discrimination. On those grounds, communities could exclude not only Arab citizens, but also other Jews of Middle Eastern descent, ultra-Orthodox Jews, or even members of the LGBTQ community. The Knesset's legal advisor, Eyal Yinon, said that along these lines, Israel's high court would likely overturn the whole law anyway if passed. This opposition, both internal and public, is probably why the Likud party is considering nixing this particular clause altogether now. Though other sections remain up for debate, including the elimination of Arabic as one of the country's official languages, a new draft of the bill would likely gain more support in the Knesset. With the summer recess set for July 22nd, the Knesset may need that support if they want the bill passed by that deadline.
Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu and Russian President Vladimir Putin are set to meet in Moscow today, and Netanyahu has already indicated that his main goal for this meeting is to get Russia's help in ousting Iran from Syria. But since Iran's foothold in the region seems only to be growing, many are left wondering whether Russia is capable or even inclined to push Iran from Israel's borders. Returning now to the studio with more on this issue is former Deputy Chief of Staff and former National Security Advisor to two Prime Ministers, Major General in the Reserves, Uzi Dayan. Thank you so much for coming back.
My pleasure.
All right, so my first question to you is Russia even capable of you know, pushing Iran away from Israel's borders? Because Putin has made it very clear, he thinks
know,
it's impossible.
Israel is like to complicate everything, but this is a simple forward answer, yes.
Russia is capable of it?
Because it's the big sponsor. He gambled on the right card. Bashar Assad is the winner by behind it. There are Russia and also Iran. But Russia is much stronger, and Russia can do it, and actually Russia is responsible for it.
So why aren't they doing it? What interests is Russia serving by not, you know, helping
well,
Israel
they
in this case?
Well, they try to balance a little bit how to support Bashar Assad and give him the best possibility to stay in power. and Iran is helping in, and the Hezbollah organization, terror organization, is helping in. And Russia don't care about Iran, but Russia don't want to go too far. But if I'm right, I think that Russia will do it. Russia will at
eventually
least push Iran off the Israeli border. And you know, the Israeli interest, Bibi went to Moscow to make sure, not for the Mondial, which is maybe also important.
That is the subtext.
But if he had to choose between meeting Putin and going to the Mondial semifinal game, he will go for Putin. And Putin, I think they can, all the cards are on the table, and Bibi is the Israeli prime minister is going to say we don't want Iran to build another outpost, Iranian outpost in Syria.
So why is Putin saying very publicly that it's impossible to oust Iran from any presence in Syria?
Because we want Israel to understand everybody that that it's a tough mission.
Maybe if Israel offered help?
You know, it's not only pushing Iran out of Syria, it's also prevent Iran from achieving nuclear capability. Imagine yourself that there is such a situation today with an Iranian UAV over Israel, and Iran is nuclear.
Well, so, speaking of a UAV, I mean, a UAV was just spotted in Israel's north not long ago today.
It was intercepted,
and a Patriot missile was intercepted it. You know, we still don't know exactly who's behind, you know, controlling the UAV.
Tell you who's behind it. Almost everything wrong in this area, Iran is behind it. It's behind Islamic Jihad in Gaza,
behind
the Hezbollah in Lebanon and in Syria.
So my final question then is, you know, how... What should Israel be doing, really, to do anything? Should Israel just step up?
It's what Israel is doing. Sure that Putin and Bashar Assad understand it, and also kind of show what Israel can do. For example, intercepting this UAV and say very clear and turn the screw on Iran and on Syria. We have a very simple interest in Syria. We don't want our people, the Israelis, to be a threat from Syria.
All right. Thank you so much, Major General, for coming in again.
Thank you.
All right. Now, the Holy Land hasn't had a major earthquake since 1927, but after over a dozen minor quakes in just the last few days, Israelis are starting to get a little nervous. Experts say that the Jewish state, which lies right on a major fault line, could be due for another big earthquake in the not-too-distant future. Clearly, the government isn't taking any chances either. The country's finance minister has just committed billions of dollars into shockproofing the country.
Despite decades of warnings, most buildings in Israel are still dangerously underprepared for the potential fallout of major earthquake. 3 years ago, an official internal report said that some 1,600 schools all over the country would be at risk of entirely collapsing. Out of those 1,600, only 53 have been reinforced. The country also lacks basic infrastructure for detecting incoming tremors or relaying alerts. Well, Finance Minister Moshe Kahron says that the government plans to invest billions in the coming years into making sure tragedy doesn't strike if and when a quake does. A proper budget still needs to be planned and approved in the coming weeks, but with residents in Tiberias literally on high alert for an incoming earthquake, obviously there's some urgency here. This investment may actually kill two birds with one stone, too. While buildings across the country are prepped for earthquake resistance, they'll also be reinforced against rockets and bombs. 500 people were killed in the earthquake that hit the Holy Land back in 1927, and let's just hope that the government can respond before such a tragedy hits us again.
Israel has often touted itself as the only safe haven for members of the LGBTQ+ community in the Middle East, but while that community is undoubtedly a treasured part of the country's identity, equality laws have sometimes been far less forthcoming. Along those lines, a new amendment to a bill expanding surrogacy laws has just been passed, excluding same-sex couples from the right to have children by the way of a third-party surrogate. LTV's Brett Allen-Smith is here with the story. Brett?
Aaron, hi. So,
Okay, so this is a bill that's still working its way through the committee, I will say, and this latest amendment has a few notable changes to it as it applies to pregnancies from surrogacies. And I'll get to the same-sex issue in a minute. But in general, okay, the bill in its new form allows single women to legally pursue the procedure in Israel, and until now only married couples, heterosexual married couples, I should be clear there, have been able to do that until now. And it also expands the limit of surrogacies for families up to five and raises the age limit for a surrogate giving the pregnancy from 38 to 39. But of course, the big bottom line here is not what's in the bill, it's what's out of it. The amendment, which would have granted the same right to same-sex couples, didn't even make it through the committee. From what I understand, the vote was quite emotional, quite personal for a lot of Knesset members, I believe.
Sure. I mean, this is the Labor, Welfare, and Health Committee we're talking about, right?
Right.
You know,
correct.
Two Knesset members on that committee are openly gay.
Right.
And I believe one of them has actually even had children through a surrogacy.
Yeah, twins. You're actually right. That's Omir Ohana you're talking about from Netanyahu's Likud party. Ohana actually begged the committee to grant this right to same-sex couples by recounting his own difficulties in his family's procedure. He and his partner had to fly to a foreign country, which means they couldn't be there for most of that pregnancy. And then when his twins were born prematurely in an emergency, that means that neither he nor his partner could be there in the hospital. I mean, can you even imagine how hard that would be to be 1,000 miles away in an emergency like that for your children?
No, I really cannot. And, you know, when the LGBTQ plus community has really thrived in Israel, especially here in Tel Aviv, you know, which is practically one of the gay capitals of the world, it's a shame that the laws don't always reflect that. But because of the current makeup of the coalition, you know, more conservative religious parties tend to shoot down same-sex equality laws pretty quickly.
Right.
You know, and if that's that's if it even gets to the floor of the Knesset in the first place.
True. Well, I think that the gay community here, at least from what I see, is really reaching a breaking point, you know, as far as that goes. You know, another Knesset member pointed out to the committee in these hearings that the LGBTQ plus Israeli community, they serve in the army, they do social service, mm-hmm. they pay taxes, they fulfill all the same duties as every other Israeli citizen in the country, so it's high time to them that the country do the right thing here and grant them the same rights as well in the exchange.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, many also feel, of course, that this can easily be done without offending, you know, the religious community or the Israeli rabbinate, you know. But I guess for now, this is a war that's far from over.
Right.
Thanks for the details, Brad.
Of course.
Despite very warm relations with Israel, the Trump administration has just made a devastating decision that may have dire consequences for Israel's economy. The United States has denied Israel's request for an exemption on American tariffs for steel and aluminum. And considering that the United States is Israel's single largest market for exports, many see this as something of a double-edged blow to Israel's wallet.
President Trump has been aggressively leveraging these and other tariffs on foreign nations in an effort to strengthen the American economy. While this effort may indeed be working in the short term, analysts worry that the practice is alienating United States allies and plunging the world into a global trade war. Trump has gloated about such a possibility in the past, tweeting that trade wars are good and easy to win. But that may be easier said than done. Trump's decision to place expensive tariffs on Canada, Mexico, and the EU have triggered something of a crisis in the global market. China has fired back with $34 billion in United States tariffs. This, in addition to hundreds of tariffs also valued in the billions from Mexico, Canada, and Europe, may put America on a collision course with its allies. Israeli officials and metal businesses are in the crosshairs here too, and are also upset to say the least. With a 25% tariff on steel and 10% on aluminum, this will certainly have a big financial consequence for Israel's metal industry. Thankfully, officials are still optimistic that Israel may yet win an exemption on other tariffs, and given the close diplomacy between the two nations, many Israelis are certainly holding out for this to be the case.
The statistics on disposable plastic, as well as the danger this poses to our environment, is well known and abundant by now. Scientists predict that at the current rate of consumption, there will be more plastic in our oceans than marine life by the year 2050. And many countries have begun clamping down on the plastic problem by banning disposable dishware altogether. Even the Al-Shabaab terror cell backed by Al-Qaeda has banned plastic bags. The trend, unfortunately, has yet to catch on in Israel, though, where its citizens consume more plastic cups than any other country per capita on Earth.
Nations all over the world are heeding the warnings of environmentalists who say that pretty soon our delicate ecosystem may pass the point of recovery if we don't cut back on plastic. Specifically, the disposable dishware, like cups, utensils, and plates, that have found their way into our oceans at a cataclysmic rate. 8 million tons of plastic is dumped into the sea every year, the same as one full garbage truck every minute. The damage here infects wildlife at the very bottom of the food chain, impacting every last organism on Earth, including us humans. While nations all over the world, including India, France, and the United States, are mobilizing to halt disposable plastic use, Israel is actually ramping up its plastic market. The makers of disposable kitchenware are seeing exponential expansion. Analysts say that the country's cultural practices of large family meals may be a factor here, too. But others point their fingers directly at the ultra-Orthodox community, where families typically only use washable dishes for special occasions. Many of these families also say that, frankly, they have no energy for washing regular dishes because of their large families. Disposable dishware is also a cheaper alternative to yeshivas than hiring a full-time dishwasher. Regardless of where this attitude comes from, its effect cannot be understated. A recent study from the Haifa School of Marine Science concluded that the amount of plastic and toxic microplastic in Israeli beaches is 9 times higher than almost anywhere else on Earth. Israel's Ministry of Environmental Protection, however, seems unconcerned with the impending danger. Their only comment so far has been that there is not yet enough data on the matter to merit any action.
One of the biggest complaints in education is that it's just not as dynamic and catered to each student as experts say it needs to be. Technology, culture, and the economic market have changed 100 times over, while the standard model of education has largely stayed the same for over a century. Well, not anymore. And here to explain is Tzvika Moshkovich, the CEO of Real Life 3D. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to have you in.
Thank you very much.
So, okay, my first question is, tell me about Artur.
Yeah, so Artur is an AI learning agent, and he's dedicated to provide these users a superior educational experience. And I'll tell you why it's important. Right now, we don't learn correctly. That means that from the basic elementary school through college and army and then academy, we have only one teacher to teach a lot of students.
Sure.
And Artur is a personal AI learning agent, and he's dedicated to provide everything that you need in order to learn.
So how does it work, and who is it for? Is it for the classroom? Is it for home use?
Okay.
For both?
Right. So today we are focusing on the industrial sector. Mm. We are enabling a very efficient new employee training. And when you get, so we have a strategic partner, then when you come to your first day at job, you get a tag name and you get the glasses and everything that you need to know on the organization and the on the business and on the customers and what you're going to do in this organization, you're going to get from Artur. Artur is going to teach you on how to work.
So, okay, so this doesn't only, you know, cater really towards the learner, but also frees up the teacher's time in this case, you know, in a business. It,
right.
it doesn't really require somebody to take time out of their day to train somebody.
Exactly.
Wow, so that cuts down on cost of training
on
new people
anything,
and everything.
On cycle time as well. So right now, if your trainer is sick or is not available or is in a meeting, so your training is being hurt, but Auto will enable everybody to learn in his pace, in his time,
sure,
and give everything that he needs to know.
Will this eventually be expanded into like the school system
yeah.
in such a way?
Yeah, so this technology
yeah.
calls augmented reality or mixed reality for mm-hmm. this kind of device. And it enables us to generate 3D holograms
sure.
that can teach us everything that we need to know. Because this kind of gear is very expensive right now, and this is only
it's
the
not
beginning.
Widely used.
Right, so only industries
right.
can use it right now. But in the future, absolutely, Auto will be the virtual teacher of everybody.
All right, well, I'm excited to see that day. Thank you so much, Tzvika, for
Thank
coming
you very
in. It was a pleasure.
Much. Thank you.
Now, yet again, Israel is welcoming in a wave of people from around the world for a very special occasion. Hundreds of athletes have just arrived for the World Lacrosse Championships set to kick off this afternoon in Netanya.
This year's World Lacrosse Championship will mark the first time since the competition's inception in 1967 that the Federation of International Lacrosse is holding a tournament outside of an English-speaking country. And there will be a record number of teams participating, with 46 nations heading into Israel to battle on the field in this 10-day contest, an increase from 38 in 2014 when the tournament was held in Denver. This year's participating teams will duel at the Wingate Institute and Netanya Stadium just next to the beautiful Mediterranean Sea, and in total, 175 games will be held throughout the tournament, with daily tickets being offered for just $45. Wednesday afternoon's opening match will witness Hong Kong face off against Luxembourg, and now the BDS movement, of course, is also having its say, and this week called for the Iroquois Nationals, a Native American team, to pull out of the competition. In a letter to the team, the BDS organizers claimed that the Wingate Institute is a settlement on Palestinian land, attempting to draw similarities between Palestinians and Native Americans. There's just one major problem with the claim. The sport facility sits on Israeli territory that is within the pre-1967 borders, meaning it's not under occupation, nor would it be returned to Palestinian rule in any future agreement. So the show will go on, and the team will play as scheduled. As for the Israeli national team, which finished 7th in the tournament 4 years ago, maybe the home team advantage will lead them to a championship this time around.
For those of you who visited Tel Aviv prior to the end of 2016, you probably remember the colorful fountain located at one of the most visited locations in the city, Dizengoff Square. Well, the fountain was temporarily taken down as part of efforts to reconstruct and upgrade the square, and finally it's been put back. LTV's Emmanuel Kadosh is here with the details. Emmanuel?
Thanks, Aaron. Well, this has literally been the talk of the town in an overnight operation, you could call it. Earlier this week, Tel Aviv's Dizengoff Square got its iconic fire and water fountain back after it was dismantled back in 2016, like you said. This was all part of a larger plan to reconstruct the plaza, upgrade, and give it more of like a modern look, you could say.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, people have been talking about it since it happened, but
right.
Also, you know, I noticed that the colored panels on the sculpture, however, currently are now stripped off. Do you know what the plan is for the fountain in the future?
Well, it's kind of sad to see it all gray and colorless. We're used to the rainbow colors, very colorful, but it has been reported that the colors of Israeli artist Yaacov Agam's piece will soon be returned. Now, a lot of Tel Avivians have been divided about the renovation since day one, first of all, because of all the traffic and, you know, noise it causes.
Sure.
You've probably experienced it yourself. And second, because we have to stare at this construction site every time we walk past, you know, Dizengoff Center to go shopping, which isn't fun. But I don't think I've heard a single person yet not agree on the fact that it was long overdue and super necessary. The square in its most recent form was not, you know, the prettiest and was definitely neglected. And I think I speak for all the residents of Tel Aviv when I say we hope the new one will be absolutely stunning.
So what exactly is the plan here then? You know, because I remember that the square used to be elevated and they removed that whole crosswalk.
Right.
You know, what's coming back?
Okay, so from what has been reported so far, the plan is to keep everything on ground level, which at the moment is in the final stages of happening, and then the new plaza will be encompassed by a traffic circle. This isn't, you know, the first time the fountain has been worked on. The fountain was constructed back in 1988 and then renovated in 2012. And actually, I read somewhere that this whole project is set to cost around something like $60 million. And if you ask me, with $60 million, this should be enough to, you know, hopefully create an absolutely stunning fountain.
Yeah, well, you know, take it from me. You can't replace Yaacov Agam's fountain. You know,
right.
I mean, the man is an Israeli treasure. His works and definitive style are just jaw-dropping. You know, take the fountain, actually, that we're talking about. You know, when it was operational, it spun, it spit fire,
yeah.
It sang songs, you know.
It did the whole thing.
At certain hours every night, right. And most of Agam's iconic works either, you know, are kinetic themselves as well, or move the eye in a continuous way.
Definitely.
With use of brilliant colors and shapes. So I'm excited to see what they're going to do.
Me too.
And how they're going to upgrade and make the square around it more modern. So thank you, Emmanuel. It's, I can't wait to see this project.
I know. We'll see you hopefully soon. So thank you.
Brought to you by IDC Summer Ulpan, open to everyone.
And now for our Hebrew word of the day. From new hit TV shows to cigarettes, it seems like many Israelis still struggle with one form of addiction or another, and that's why today's word is hitmakrut, or addiction. Some people are mechul, or addicted to dangerous things like adrenaline or alcohol, and I don't know about you, but I have a few hitmakruyot, or addictions of my own. Thankfully, they're not considered so serious. You know, I'm mostly just mechul, or addicted to annoying songs that get trapped in my head and, like the half of the rest of the planet, copious amounts of caffeine. That being said, when any hitmakrut or addiction, even caffeine, gets the better of us, remember that it's okay to ask for help. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the weather forecast. Tonight will be warm with clear skies and a low of 77 or 24 degrees Celsius. Tomorrow you can expect more partly cloudy skies and warm weather with a high of 85 or 29 degrees Celsius. All right, that's it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.64 shekels to the American dollar. Remember to sign up for our daily newsletter at iltv.tv, and don't forget to follow us on Facebook at Israel English News and on Twitter at iltv News. I'm Aaron Porras. Thank you for watching.